It is with great pleasure that we introduce today's host of the Roswell Interview, Insights into Humanity's Cosmic History, Part 2 of 3, Dr. Zhou Qingrong. With a PhD in Electrical Engineering and Computer Science, Dr. Zhou has been involved in telecommunications for 29 years. He has supported the evolution of wireless network technologies from 1G through 4G, with 5G now just around the corner. As a distinguished member of technical staff at Nokia Corporation, his primary focus is perfecting mobile network performance for a bright future of enhanced communication.
开悟的观众您好，欢迎收看罗斯威尔事件访谈，洞悉人类的宇宙历史三集节目的第二集。我是来自台湾的周庆荣，台湾又称为福尔摩沙。福尔摩沙人民祝福大家永远蒙受上天的恩泽。劳伦斯·斯宾塞编辑并出版《外星人访谈》这本书的内容包含马克·埃罗伊女士的笔记和机密文件。马克·埃罗伊女士曾经是美国女子空军部队医务组的护士。这本书中，她宣称1947年时，她曾在美国新墨西哥州的罗斯威尔这个地方和外星人进行访谈，时间长达六个星期。这位外星人名叫埃罗，是一艘太空船的驾驶。斯宾塞先生在以下谈话中分享了书中一些引人入胜的讯息。
Ms. McElroy transcribes that Errol refers to us as beings as ISBEs, meaning immortal spiritual beings.
Essentially, the pilot says, in her opinion, that every sentient being is an immortal spiritual being. Regardless of what kind of body they inhabit or not.
I mean, or what planet they came from or not.
Yeah, whether they're situated in the physical universe or not. Obviously, a spiritual entity doesn't have to inhabit a body. But in the case of Earth, Earthlings inhabit a biological body, which to the degree that they're mortal through the inhabitation of or animation of a body, doesn't negate the fact thatin the grand scheme of things, we are individually and collectively immortal spiritual entities.
Aylor 指出，我们的银河系在数百万年前曾被残酷、集权而独裁的旧帝国统治。这个帝国残暴的统治者指定地球在旧帝国中扮演特别的角色。大约1000年前，有一股慈悲的新统治力量，也就是埃罗所属的统领地，派遣3000士兵的远征部队来到地球，才意外发现地球的角色。
It was discovered accidentally by this domain installation of about 3,000 officers and other personnel of the domain that Earth has been being used as a prison planet for who knows how long time, certainly hundreds of thousands of years, but more recently and more actively since about 30,000 years ago, I think she says. But at that time, they weren't aware that there were military establishments of the old empire in this solar system. So they were attacked and the Himalaya base was destroyed, and the domain beings who were as part of that force in the Himalayas were captured as spiritual entities and taken off and reinterred or incarcerated in the Earth prison planet system. So consequently, the domain sent several other follow-up missions to the area to try to recover those people, those personnel, who were by that time in biological bodies. So they went all over the world, through the air and under the water and land and so forth, trying to establish the identity of who, what happened to their officers or where they were. And many, many attempts were made, which he describes in some detail, to contact and establish communication and extricate those personnel from the biological bodies they were trapped in, unsuccessfully. Apparently, according to the pilot, they discovered over a period of time that this planet and the surrounding area, it's not just the planet itself, it's apparently the surrounding area is set up with electronic force screens or something like that, some mechanism that identifies the frequency, the spiritual frequency of each individual being, sort of like your cell phone could identify you by GPS no matter where you are on the planet. There's a unique frequency signature that identifies the location of that phone. Similarly, each individual being emanates a frequency themselves energetically. It's very unique and identifiable to each individual, and it really doesn't have anything to do with the body so much. It has to do with the being themselves. So essentially what she says they discovered over a period of time was that this prison system, however it works, no one really knows for sure, but apparently it's set up using very, very sophisticated technology by the old empire to keep everybody behind this kind of electronic fence or something. And part of that is the wipe out of the memory of the spiritual being before they are brought to Earth as a spiritual entity and put into a biological body, so that they don't remember where they're from or who they are or how they got here or anything about their previous existence. The pilot says that they use billions of volts of electricity to erase the memory of an immortal being, which immortality itself suggests the idea that you've existed forever and will continue to exist forever. So to wipe out that much memory that thoroughly is probably no small feat. So the biological body, according to what the pilot says, is part of that prison system.
埃罗揭露的讯息真是令人惊奇不已，我们要花一点时间去感受天堂的爱。 敬请锁定无上师电视台。
Headline edition, July 8, 1947. The Army Air Forces has announced that a flying disc has been found and is now in the possession of the Army.
Welcome to the program, Roswell 事件访谈，洞悉人类的宇宙历史，第二集的节目，我们继续访问劳伦斯·斯宾塞先生，在他编辑出版的《外星人访谈》这本书中。外星人埃罗叙述了自己的身体和地球上的物质身体是怎么产生的。
For example, the pilot herself isn't using a biological body. She's using what she refers to as a doll body, which is designed specifically for the operation of the spacecraft, or for her role as an officer and an engineer and a pilot. Those kinds of bodies are manufactured.They can be used interchangeably. Some of the bodies have different purposes depending on the role that the person plays, and they can attach tools to them or whatever they want. Not exactly like robots, much more sophisticated than that, but same idea. The body is used as a tool. It's not something that you inhabit by choice, except to carry out the functions of your assigned tasks. But the pilot says that the hierarchy of the domain at the higher levels doesn't use bodies at all. In fact, they avoid using bodies because it's easy to get entrapped in a body. But the biological bodies, on the other hand, have been designed over a very, very long period of time, specifically as a way of enslaving or entrapping various beings throughout the universe for a very, very, very long time, trillions of years, she says, specifically for that purpose, to kind of keep a segment of the population enslaved and located and identifiable for whatever purposes. One of the most interesting things to me is her description of the character of the population of the ISBs on Earth, which she says she refers to as untouchables, which is obviously a term that's been used in an English translation of a term used in India for a long time, which essentially is anyone who's undesirable, unwanted, an outcast, a low caste, someone to be avoided. So the beings inhabiting biological bodies, in the opinion of the old empire government, or the secret society, essentially what she refers to as the Brotherhood of the Serpent, were for whatever reason interested in getting rid of people from their population. Either they're psychopaths, they're perverts, they're criminals, or they're the other end of the spectrum. They're too creative, they're geniuses, whose genius and inventiveness is no longer needed in a civilization that's been around for billions and billions of years, wherein everything is already invented. As with any totalitarian government, it has its own definition of what's desirable and what's not, and its own codes. So the people on Earth, for a wide variety of reasons, were sent to Earth to just get rid of them permanently, forever. When you're sent to Earth as a prison, doesn't necessarily indicate that you're a bad person or that you've done anything wrong, or you're just undesirable in the context of that civilization and their judgment. Part of the prison system mechanism is not just amnesia, but this planet itself was chosen because of the very volatile nature of the planet. Volcanoes, tsunamis, hurricanes, polar shifts, the continents are crashing into each other continually. This planet is kind of a cement mixer of natural elements, which make a long-term civilization really not possible. You just can't build a house and expect it's going to be there 10,000 years from now, much less 100,000 or a million years from now, because it's going to be gone. It's going to be under an ocean, or one day it's under the ocean, and 100,000 years later it's at the top of the Himalayas.
感谢劳伦斯·斯宾塞先生分享书中的精彩内容。青海无上师曾多次谈到外星人以及他们如何帮助我们。以下是青海无上师的开示。1995年6月10日讲于福尔摩沙，福尔摩沙又称为台湾。
Many of the UFO are very friendly, very very friendly. They just look different. So the earth people are frightened of them and sometimes do them harm. That's a pity. You should not do that.Should not do that, should leave them alone. And whenever a UFO crash landed on our Earth, we should help them as much as possible to repair their vehicle and speed them back home as soon as possible. That will do tremendous good to our planet. In time of trouble, these people will come and help us unconditionally. Otherwise, we make enemy for nothing. They are our friends.They're watching the planet just like we have to watch the mountain for landslide, or we have to watch some water some water, some troubled water somewhere in order to prevent disaster. They're not intending to harm us. Those harmful ones are not from the intelligent life. Those harmful ones are from devils, from Satan. It's different, different force altogether.
感谢亲切的观众，今天一起收看节目。下周一，4月23日，请继续收看罗斯威尔事件访谈，洞悉人类的宇宙历史最后一集。无上师电视台接下来播出增进健康的纯素长寿饮食两集节目的第二集。愿您一天比一天高雅，或者平静受尊重的喜乐生活。 Gracious viewers, thank you for joining us today. Please tune in again next Monday, April 23rd for the final episode of The Roswell Interview, Insights into Humanity's Cosmic History. Coming up next is Vibrant Health with Plant-Based Macrobiotics.Part 2 of 2, here on Supreme Master Television. May your life be graced with peace, respect, and joy as you grow in nobility every day. For more details, please visit suprememastertv.com/ss.